Praise the Lord. Come on, say amen again. Amen. Good to see you today. Glad that you're here to worship with us. You know, for those who've consistently come in the last several Sundays, you see that we have been in our study on Nehemiah. And so if you're first time to be with us, this is a study about leadership and how God used this man and called him to a place of leadership to accomplish a task that, man, others hadn't been able to accomplish over the last 100 years. You know, multiple attempts had been made. They weren't able to get her done. But he does. He steps on the scene. We saw several things in our first four lessons. One was that he was a man of character. Two, that he was a man who prayed. Three, he was a man who spent time with God to get a plan. And we learned how last week how he motivated the people with what he had and how God uses, you know, proper motivation with people and what biblical motivation is. It's not guilt tripping, but it's reminding the people, you know, that we're the people of God. We've been called to a higher task, and we need to be busy about what God's called us to do. And as you follow this story through, in fact, as I've in studying research and preparing for this, I see that a lot of pastors who've taught on Nehemiah skip this chapter because it's just a long list, kind of like in Genesis when you get to what I call the begets. You know, so-and-so begat so-and-so, and he begat so-and-so, and he begat so-and-so, who begat so-and-so, and you go down that list. Well, understand that all Scripture is inspired for God. And there's a message somewhere in those begets. I'm still working on it, but I think I found it in chapter 3, all right? Because in chapter 3, there's a long list of names about who did what on the wall. But it's an important list. You know, when you're reading the book of Hebrews, there's that chapter 11. And the writer of Hebrews builds up to the faith life and the faith walk and how we live by faith. And then in chapter 11, he mentions all those, what we call the hall of faith, the hall of fame. And he mentions, I refer to them as heroes. I mean, these are the guys you want to, you know, exemplify, and these are the guys you want to be like, you know, and emulate. Those are the heroes of faith. Well, Nehemiah chapter 3, that's the chapter 11 of Hebrews, basically, for Nehemiah, where he lists all these people who got out and did what needed to be done on the wall, so it's relevant and it's important that we pay attention to what it is because, again, all Scripture is inspired. So we don't want to skip over it. I think there's some practical lessons that we can learn from this and that we can glean from this that will help us in our life, whether we're in leadership in our home or our jobs or wherever we might be. And the part, the most amazing thing about this chapter is it shows you just how practical the Word of God can be. If you take a little longer to look at it and kind of turn it from side to side, and you also see just how applicable. I mean, how you can apply this to your everyday life in so many different ways. Again, it doesn't matter where you are in your life. All of us are supposed to be leaders, right? All of us are to have an inspiration in our heart that the Lord has led us to and has called us to and we should be getting a hold of. So we're going to look at some principles from God's Word today. And really, you know, these are the principles from the Word on how to organize a project. As bland as that might sound, there's some really good stuff here. And how Nehemiah goes about it and organizes this. And this all works with the flow. Remember in chapter 1 where he gets a word from the king, gets permission, he's fasted, he's prayed. And then in chapter 2, remember we talked about how he went and he got there and he didn't do anything for 3 days that we could see. But what he was doing, he was taking those midnight rides, remember, around the city. And I believe what came out of those midnight rides is what's in chapter 3 of how the work was literally put together and how it was organized. And that came out of, you know, prayer, and it came out of planning. We talked about how to biblically plan things for your life, no matter if it's your quiet time to raising your family or working on your job, however it applies. There's application for us here, so we just don't want to rush by stuff. And so that could be boring, all right? Because there are some great principles in here that we can learn from. So let's look at just the first 5 verses, because we could read all 30-some-odd verses, but they're real repetitive with a lot of names that I can't pronounce. Is that a good excuse? But I'll let you read them and let you try. Remember, try hard because you're going to meet these people one day. All right, this isn't Grimm's fairy tales. You know, this isn't like Winnie the Pooh. These people are real, okay? And so you're going to, I don't think we're having trouble running into Pooh when we get to heaven, but I won't go there. All right, anyway, let's get to verse 1. And look at verses 1 through 5. And it says, Eliashib, the high priest, rose with his brothers and the priest and built the sheep gate. And they consecrated it and hung the doors. And they consecrated the wall to the Tower of the Hundred and the Tower of Hananel. And next to him, the men of Jericho built. And next to them, Zakur, the son of Imri, built. Now the sons of Hasaniah built the fish gate. And they laid its beams and hung its doors with its bolts and its bars. And next to them was Meremoth, the son of Uriah, the son of Hakoz, made repairs. And next to him, Meshulam, the son of Bechariah, the son of Meshezebel, made repairs. And next to them, Zadok, the son of Baana, also made repairs. And moreover, next to him, the Tekoites made repairs. But their nobles didn't support the work of their masters. All right, we're going to look through these. And again, there's a lot of verses seem to repeat this whole mindset. And we'll kind of highlight a few of them as we go. But there is some strategic things we can learn for our own personal life and where it applies. First of all, catch this principle. One is that, you know, God is the one who said everything should be done in an orderly, in a fit manner. It should be done in the proper way. God is the one who is the God of order. If you even look at creation and how the creation comes and he lays out everything in order, I mean, he prepares the earth, he prepares the waters from the seas, the light of the day, he prepares the very atmosphere, prepares everything before he puts a man in it. All right? You got to have air to breathe, the place to stand. So there's an order to even in creation how God establishes everything. In fact, we're going to look at, like we've done in each one of these lessons, what we'll call these leadership laws, and it's this one. Last week we looked at motivation, but motivation without organization leads to frustration. And as you look at this whole process of chapter 3, you'll see there's been a lot of organization and a lot of proper planning before we ever got to that point of motivating people. You remember how he motivated them? He motivated by reminding them that they were God's people. And he motivated by saying, hey, this is the city of God. This place lies in ruins. This is disgrace. This is not what God's called us to. We live for higher purposes. And he motivated them with a higher call. And he motivated them with eternal things, you know, and internal things more than the external things. So we understand that he's motivated them. In chapters 2 and 3, Matt, they're ready to put their hands to work. And in chapter 3, it begins. Let's start with the first principle. We'll look about 6 or 7 today. The principle of simplification. Anybody in management knows this. It's the KISS rule, the KISS rule, right? What's it mean? Keep it simple, stupid. Why? Because I'm never surprised how we can easily overpass this simple law of just application to our life. Keep it simple. One thing you look about this whole chapter, you're going to see the simplicity of how these people went to work. You know, the U.S. Constitution is about what? I guess in normal written little booklet form, it's about, it's a manual for operating a nation of millions, of hundreds of millions of people, and it's about 21 pages long. If you're a Toyota Camry owner, there's a manual in your glove box, if you've ever looked at it. Your car seats about 5 people, not hundreds of millions. And that manual is about 300 pages long. I don't think that anybody's probably ever read it. But nonetheless, it is there and it's a manual. What happened? You know, keep it simple. This is an enormous project. Remember, it's been tried by other people for 90-something years. It hadn't been accomplished yet. He didn't go in there, you know, with a bunch of weird charts and organizational methods and routines and come up with all these kind of abstract rules. Hey, there's a wall. It's broken down. We need to rebuild it, you know. And he organizes, if you follow the story, he organizes around simple, natural groupings. First, it says the priest in verse 1. They did their section. The men of Jericho, in verse 2, they did a section. The sons of Hasaniah, in verse 3. The men of Tekoa, in verse 5. I mean, these are all natural groups as you go through this whole chapter. And all these natural groups naturally work together already. He didn't have to go in and create a bunch of new organizations, all right? He took what he had, and he began to work with it. It's the old rule as well as the KISS rule, is if it ain't broke, don't try to fix it, all right? And there's nothing more natural, and there's no more natural grouping than these tribes and these families in the nation of Israel. And if you follow their history, this is the way God dealt with them. He dealt with them by tribe. He dealt with them by family. And he used those natural groups that he had already set in place to do what needed to be done. So simply put is, you don't have to go out and create organization you don't need. You don't need to create little groups that aren't necessarily needed. You use these most natural groupings, all right? The leadership laws, the strongest organizations usually are the simplest. In fact, many times the more they grow, the more complex they become, and the heavier, it's kind of like the U.S. government, which is so heavy now and so big and so complex, most people don't know what the other people are doing in the organization to start with. That's why very little ever gets done, all right? You may be a big government person, I don't care, but the issue is pretty plain. You don't have to argue the point. It's a mess. Then there's the principle of participation, all right? The principle of participation is you work, and this is a lesson for anybody in ministry, all right? You work with those who want to work. And this is a lesson that was hard for me to learn in the beginning days of pastoring a church because I wanted everybody to work. But not everybody's going to work. And you see this even in this process here. You know, and I've seen leaders and pastors even, they spend all their time trying to corral apathetic people or corral the lazy folks to do something instead of spending the time where it needs to be spent in investing their time in working with those who want to work, all right? You can't spend all your time corralling goats. You got to work with sheep, amen? And you move forward with work with those that want to work, all right? That leadership laws, love everybody, but move with movers. If you're going to have, if you have a strategic plan in front of you to do something, let's get it done. It's hard to corral folks that don't really want to be doing what they may have been called to do, but they're not doing. It says, if you follow the story here, almost everybody got to work. If you follow the list here, you see the upper crust, the lower crust. You see the people who were the jewelers to the refiners of gold. You see the perfume makers. You see the government leaders. You see the business leaders. You see the priests getting involved. I mean, everybody's making mortar. Everybody's moving bricks. Everybody's doing something for the most part, except one little group. That little group we mentioned in verse 5. The next section repaired by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervisors or under their masters. All right? There was a group who just, you know, for whatever reason, they think they're too hot for this kind of work, or they think they're too good for the dirty work or the wall and moving bricks and making, you know, mortar, you know. It doesn't say what excuse they gave. I'm sure they had several, you know. But in every project, in every church, there's people like this, all right? In every, some of you have people like this in your own family, perhaps. They don't want to work with the family to be the unit God's called it to be. But there's just people like this. In every kind of project, every ministry, every church, there's always two kinds of people. You got your workers and you got your shirkers, all right? It really breaks down to that kind of a simple of a deal. What do you need to do with it? You focus on those who are the workers, not the shirkers. You don't lose sleep. You don't get upset. You don't get bit. Now, for me as a pastor, that was one of the hardest lessons to learn. We'd call a work day, you know, and you have a group show up, but then you'd be like, well, why didn't so-and-so show up? Or why didn't they show up? Or why didn't they show up? And some of you have got here the work days like that. You say, well, where's so-and-so? Where's so-and-so? Hey, don't worry about them. You know, we got the group we need. We got those who are ready to work. Got those who are ready to do something. Let's not lose sleep over those who aren't. But there's, I don't remember where I got this from, but it was pretty good. So there's four main bones in every organization. First one's the wishbone. They just wish somebody would do something about the problem. Hey, man, somebody needs to build that wall. Then you have your wishbones, you have your jawbones. Jawbones do all the talking, but that's about all that ever gets accomplished by them. Then you got your knuckle bones. They just knock everything. They knock everybody, knock the chore, knock the task. And then you got your backbones. Backbones are the folks who carry the load. They're going to take on the brunt of the load, and they're going to do most of the work. Those are the people you work with. Those are the people you move with. You know, every time, you know, in the early days when I planned a project or a work event or a party, wanted people to show up, it was so easy to just look around the room and say, well, so-and-so, why didn't they show? Why didn't they show? You know, there's so many more people that could do something and be here to get something done. Hey, forget about it. Forget about it. Work with those that want to work. Move forward. Press on. Get the project done. The leadership law is simple. You love everybody, but what do? You move with those who want to move. Don't focus on the people who are like the nobles and the Tekoites who have excuses. Just move forward. The third principle, we call it the principle of delegation. Now, this is obviously a big task. There's a wall, surrounds the city, all right, and specific assignments have to be made. You have to divide this project up. And obviously, Nehemiah's done this. And I think he did this when he's in that planning process, obviously. When he's riding around the city, he's drawing up specific tasks, assigning specific people to those tasks. I mean, after this little pep rally, where there's a prayer meeting and a motivational rally, you know, everybody gets excited and they said, let's rebuild the wall. He didn't jump up and say, okay, just get out there and get after it wherever you want to go. You know, because usually that leads to nothing but, you know, chaos. In fact, there's a word that keeps coming up in this chapter 13 times. In fact, it uses this word sections. In other words, certain people did certain sections of the wall. If you walk around the entire wall, you know, it's like he did, I believe. It's like he went around the wall counterclockwise and he divided up in those sections as he went around the clock counterclockwise. And he says, this wall is taken care of by this people, this gate by these people, this wall was taken care of by people, this gate was taken by people. In fact, there is a mention of American politics, I believe it's in verse 26, where it talks about Watergate. Anyway, obviously, Nehemiah's thought this out, you know, and he's planned it out. And I do believe he did it when he made those rides at night. He's kept it simple. He's worked with those that want to work. And now he's making some specific assignments to people because it talks about supervisors and leaders. What do you do when it comes to time to delegate? How is that done? One, it's a big goal. We got to build a wall, but we need to break it down into manageable, smaller tasks, into bite-sized pieces. You want to build a church? How are you going to do that? There's a church that we support in our budget, and Pastor Patrick Stewart is, in fact, he's going to be one of our speakers at the marriage retreat this year. When he first came to me several years ago about the church, and we had started a church, and we're trying to get some insight and some direction, he came in and he had this manual about like this he put together, and just hundreds of pages. And he says, what do you think I ought to do, Pastor? I said, I think you ought to, you know, I appreciate all the work you put in that, but I think you ought to forget that manual. Because it won't work out like you think it is, number one. I said, when we started Believers Fellowship, we wanted to keep it as simple as possible. You know, keep it simple. I said, we've discovered, and we talk about this often in our leadership areas in ministries, that, you know, that the form will follow the function. You know, focus on the function. You know, what's God calling us to do? What do you believe is on our heart to do? What do you believe is the first thing God wants us to do? And what happens is God begins to put together the form as the function goes to work. Talk too often, we want to have this big form and we want to pour ourselves into that, you know, and we get all bound up by what's on page paragraph 3B of page 14 or whatever, you miss what needs to be done so often. It will develop. It will take shape. God will give clarity to it. And he has over the years. It seems that, you know, he's given clarity and direction and specificity to the task as they go down. But you don't start with all that. You start where you're at. There's a wall in front of me. That's where he says, Joe, you need to work on the wall that's in front of you. And you start working there. I mean, when we first started the church, we had about 30 people, I think, 25, 35 people. And we all had tasks. We were meeting in hotels and then to schools and then to other places. But in those early days, I mean, we had a trailer full of equipment and we hauled it around and somebody was supposed to pick it up. Somebody was supposed to drop it off. Somebody was supposed to load it. We had people take care of the music stuff. We had people take care of the chairs to get out of it. Everybody, there was a nursery group of people. There was, you know, youth group people. Everybody had their task, you know, and they knew exactly what to do. Man, we'd have church ready in 30 minutes. Man, we could set that thing up. But it meant that some people had to get there 30 minutes before that 30 minutes. But they knew who they were and they knew what they needed to do. They had those small tasks. And all of a sudden, boom, there's a great worship service going on. You develop with that clear job description. Everyone deserves to know what's expected of them. All too often when people are given responsibilities, even in church, you know, they say, well, you're in charge of this. They don't get some clear instruction. You don't know what your responsibility is. Most likely, you're not going to fulfill your responsibility, all right? When you start having these clear job descriptions, you know what's expected of you. Third part of that is, and these are principles we tried to work with even in our own church, is you match the responsibility with that right person. Right person, right task. Even today, when we're looking for people to do ministry in our church, we want them to be the right person for the right place. They need to know that this is what God's called them to do. They need to know that they're operating in their spiritual gift. They need to know that they're operating according to the motivation of their own heart. This is what they enjoy doing. This is where their place is. This is where they like to serve. That's why we have our 301 classes, to help people understand what their spiritual gifts are. And then to follow that up and saying, hey, what is it that excites you in ministry? What is it that excites you in the church? Let's get plugged in there. Let's do that specific task. Let's let that be where you focus on. And what happens there, then God begins to do something special. Now, everybody's responsibility, you know, is the same out there. Then usually nothing gets done. It's like having a work day and say, okay, we need to do this. We're gonna do this. We're going to paint the walls. Usually the walls don't get painted right, you know. Somebody needs to know what kind of paint we're supposed to have. Somebody needs to know what kind of application we're going to do. Somebody needs to know how to show somebody else how to do it. I mean, there's responsibilities. You break it all down into tasks that everybody understands. They have a specific responsibility. Somebody's setting it up. Somebody's cleaning it up. Somebody's getting ladders. Somebody's doing this. Somebody's taping stuff off. There's all that stuff to be done. In our own spiritual life, this is true. What are you facing out there? What's before you in your ministry? What's before you in your lift group? What's before you in your study group or your different area of ministry, whether it's the pantry or the food pantry or the clothing, whatever it is, there's tasks and projects all along. This is just simple biblical instruction. How do we get it done? And it's interesting, God doesn't skip over this stuff. He lays it out in the Word of God how it was done. Along with this is the fourth principle. We call it the principle of motivation, all right? In organizing any project, people have to assume ownership. And when they don't, they completely miss it. That leadership law, good organization, allows for workers to develop their own areas. In other words, people come to me and they say, you know, our brother Tim, we have a desire to start this particular ministry. Well, I don't want to sit down and say, well, okay, that should be this way, it should be this way, it should be. The Lord's already been dealing with them about that. God's been giving them clarity on it. Now, what we want to do is inspect the biblical aspect and the spiritual aspect of it to see it all lines up with the Word of God. But God's already given them something in their heart to do. That's why we don't do a lot. Like a lot of churches, if you grew up in a Baptist church, you know you have lots of committees. And you have a committee over them called the Committee on Committees. Directly under the committee on the committees is a chairman in charge of the nomination committee. Now, the nomination committee chairman and his group are responsible for getting every ministry in the church personnel to work within that ministry. This is where we have the form without the function. We have this is ministry. So we need to go find people to plug into these different areas to work in. And so the nominating chairman goes out and starts nominating people. You know, and he'll come up to somebody and say, oh, brother so-and-so, you need to work with the junior boys, you know, because we need somebody in the junior boys. And he's thinking in the back of his mind, I don't know what to do with junior boys, you know. I'm old, they're going to give me a heart attack. But, you know, nonetheless, the nominating committee guy, he knows how to put it, oh, you know, you love Jesus, right? It's always usually the gimmick, isn't it? Oh, if you love Jesus, I love Jesus. Oh, well, then you got it, boy. It's all yours. The other guy may hate kids, who knows? But the idea is, you know, you want to find people who have a vision, a passion to work with junior boys. You know, God's given them a heart for that age group and that important part of their life right there where they're developing so many different ideas and the scope of the philosophy of their life. That's when you can really make an impact in someone's life. And God's given people that. So, you know, we want to find people who are motivated because this is where they feel led to work. I mean, you want to help people feel it's their project. If you follow this, this is found in this passage. Verse 10 says, this guy made repairs opposite his house. Verse 23, same thing. And this guy, he made repairs in front of his house. Verse 28, and this guy, another guy, he built in front of his house or beside his house. In fact, the priest, it says, they prepared in front of their own living quarters. And a guy, in verse 30, says, you know, he repairs in front of his house. Down the list it goes, each of these people, and catch the uniqueness of how Nehemiah does this. God gives us some real clear insight here. He gets them to rebuild the wall in front of where their life and business is taking place. All right? You say, why do that? Tremendous amount of ownership goes into it there. In other words, if I'm building the wall in front of your house, it might not be as good as the wall in front of my house. I'm going to have a little thicker, a little tighter on the mortar. I mean, a little bigger on the bricks. It's going to be a little more secure in front of my house. If the wall's there for protecting us from the enemy. But in this beautiful way, the Lord does this. He gets them in areas of interest and where there's ownership and where there's a desire and a passion for something. The result of when you allow folks ownership in a project, there's this high motivation, you know, of their own testimony, of their own integrity, for the glory of God, you know. I'm going to start right here. I mean, the beauty of this is nobody has to commute to the other side of town to get their wall built. They're walking right out there, you know, and boom, they're right at work. It's convenient as possible. It says in verse 1, Eliashib, the high priest, and his fellow workers, they went to work and they rebuilt the sheep gate. Why that? That's the one closest to the temple. That's where the sheep were brought in for the sacrifice, where they would inspect the sheep. That's where business took place for these men, in other words, and ministry took place. So Nehemiah is getting people to be involved in the areas where they have a heart, where they have an interest, where they have a desire. And if it's a good organization, that's exactly what happens here. People are allowed to work where their heart is and where their passion is, all right? So we try to allow people in our fellowship, you know, to work where their heart is and where they can take ownership over it. The fifth organization or principle is this. It's the principle of cooperation. Now, the passage in Ezekiel says, you know, that two can accomplish more than one, right? The result can be twice as much. It can be better. If one falls, the other pulls them up. If man falls when he's alone, he's in trouble. So there's this idea of corporation over the whole wall. It's like Nehemiah, he's already said, this, we're the family of God. You know, this is not about just your house, my house. This is our house. This is God's city, and we're God's people. So we're gonna cooperate together. We're not just kind of go randomly at that kind of plan, like Russian roulette with God's will, you know. They're approaching this whole project together. Nehemiah works, as I said, counterclockwise around this wall as he goes through this process, and you see everybody involved and everybody on one common task, which is for the good of the whole group there. Cooperation is strategic. It's important on your job and your family, especially in your church. There must be this attitude of coming together. We do, more than any other organization in the world, we have a common interest. We love Jesus. We have a common goal, the gospel to the world. We have a common passion, the glory of God in our life. So we want to commit together. This is not about you. And, you know, one thing we always remind our people when we have our leadership, it's not just about your ministry. What your ministry does, it's helping the whole. We're working this together. California anthropologist who wrote it years ago, Angeles Arian, he wrote about after a thesis on the study of geese, you know. And after this great study, he said, you know, when geese fly in a group, they can fly 71% further when they're in formation when they can fly when they're alone. That's phenomenal. I mean, because they go hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of miles, twice every year, thousands some of them. Well, they're traversing this tremendous amount of territory. And they can get there much quicker and much more efficiently. But if they're flying alone, I mean, can you imagine the 71% loss in performance? I mean, each bird flapping his wings. I mean, I was watching part of the Olympics and the bike riders yesterday, you know, they're coming across and you watch those guys and they're getting behind each other. What are they're drafting. They're getting in that little vortex. Well, geese create a tremendous draft behind themselves. You got one guy up front, he's just beating his wings like crazy. You follow down the line and it's a little less as they go down the line. And they're in this beautiful formation because when they're in formation, there's the least resistance is going on. But when they fall out of formation, more resistance starts going. They feel it and they can't go as far. You know, in fact, folks, listen to this. If we had as much sense as a goose, we'd fall into cooperating in the will of God together. Amen. But a lot of folks don't have much sense as a goose. When one gets tired, the lead goose tires out, he just kind of peels off and makes his way to the back of the formation. Next guy in line moves right up and gets after it. Starts whipping it up and getting on down the road. He gets tired, then he goes back. In fact, when one is wounded or one gets sick, falls out of the formation, two geese will go with him. To either he either dies or he revives, and then they get back in the line to follow. Yeah, you know, who taught them that? They go to geese school to get that? I don't have geese school. Got a school of fish, but no school of geese. God taught them that. And I think if we listen to the Holy Spirit long enough, we see that God teaches us that. We're living in a lonely, lonely world. You know, I sat in there last night, Kathy and I were watching the Olympics. They put one of these ads on for, you know, how to find your mate in life. You know, there's 14 different dating sites out there and stuff. I says, you know, just come to church. If they baby get back in church, they find husbands and wives, but they all quit coming to church. Amen. Amen. They went to the bars. You know how those marriages work out a lot of times. Some of you got like that, but you got saved in time. Amen. You got saved in time. You get back in church, fill the church up. And we'd be doing weddings all the time. Amen. I told a guy the other day, we were down there and doing Belize missions. He said, I've just been out of church. I'm looking for a wife. I said, let me ask you where you're looking. And he told me, I said, you don't want to find one there. You don't want to find one there. You want to find one in a church. Get back in church, you know. Get back seeking God. Got to meet the needs of your life. But the idea here is this cooperation. But we're living in a culture that people are just lonely. You know, there's no lone rangers in the New Testament. We're together. We're a family. We organize as God's people, all right? In fact, if you look at the book of Acts in those first 10 chapters, you know that the words unity or in one accord, you know, or in one, you know, or unified or one heart, that term's used 10 times in the first 10 chapters. And look what they accomplished in the first 10 chapters of Acts. Look at the supernatural things that God did because people gathered together with one heart and one mind, want to see God do one big glorious thing. I mean, snow's a good demonstration of that. One little old snowflake by itself ain't going to do much. Is it? Kind of hits the windshield and melts. But you get enough of those flakes together, you can stop traffic. Don't see a lot of that in Houston, but the facts are there. You get enough of us flakes together, we can change the world. But we got to get rid of this isolation mentality, you know, and get rid of the mindset and the idea that we don't need the world. You know, I read an article the other day that talked about the millennials, you know, the generation we call the millennials today. You know, they said that 75% of them wouldn't go to church even if asked. That's sad. But a good point for Lift Group. 55% of them said they'd go to a home group if somebody asked them. So it shows how important what we're doing with our Lift Ministries is. Amen? People don't think they need church. People don't need, what they don't realize is that God never intended us to live isolated lives like that. Own little world, own little, but what a meaningless life if it's just all about me. Where's the meaning? Where's the direction? What's it all about? You miss life completely. Then there's the principle of administration. The principle of administration is that, you know, and it's applied all the way through the messages. Somebody's out there and somebody's supervising the work. I mean, you see this all the way through the scripture. Nehemiah's out there and he's managing the situation. But, you know, there's several passages here. You know, it talks about under the supervision, like verse 17, verse 18 says they were under this guy. They were under this guy. And verse 5 says they wouldn't get under their supervisors. So obviously Nehemiah is told and given direction that certain people would oversee certain areas of the walk. Well, what's Nehemiah doing? Well, Nehemiah just, he's supervising, but he's out on the line. He's out where the people are, and he's administrating as he goes along. There's a book out there called Passion for Excellence by Tom Peters, and he calls it MBWA, Management by Walking Around. He's there, he's encouraging the supervisors, he's working with them, they're working with the people, and God is getting unbelievable things done. Because he's out there, he's doing what he's called to do, inspecting, supervising, giving leadership. Those people under him are giving leadership and moving forward. A couple of leadership laws to catch here. One, good organization establishes clear lines of authority. That works in the home, it works in the job place, it works in the church. Everybody knows who they can get information from. Everybody knows who they can talk to. Everybody knows who they can report to. Everybody has a response, and everybody understands the context of what authority means. And there are very clear lines of authority. It's not that in authority anybody is any better than anybody else. God says this is the way it will get done, though. This is the method we're going to use. So let's respond to it. The second leadership principle there is people do what you inspect, not what you expect. Say, what do you mean? We were talking about this, I think, several years ago in one of our staff retreats. My son brought this up, and he was on staff for about a year and a half here. He brought this up in one of the staff retreats. We were sharing what we thought were good things that we'd learned in ministry or in the world, in business, that would help us in different areas of our ministry. Because in a staff meeting, we kind of get out the list, and every staff member has multiple responsibilities, you know. I mean, there may be 5 things under one staff member's list of what they're responsible for, 10 under another, 7 under another, you know. And everybody's responsible for different areas and oversight of different ministries. Some take a little time, some take more time. And so, you know, but one of the best things that Joseph brought up that time, he says, you know, he said, what I've discovered is that people do what you inspect, not what you expect. In other words, you can tell people, you can do this for your kids, you can tell your expectations all day long. But if you ain't checking up on them, it ain't getting done. Amen? Homeschoolers know this. Amen? You know, you need to inspect what you expect. And if you don't inspect it, you shouldn't expect it. Because most time, if there's no responsibility to what we've been called to do, many times the lack of accountability is just what most people need to do, to do nothing. I'm not accountable. But if it's important, if it needs to get done, then we need to inspect it. You know, and if you're on a job as a supervisor in any category, write that down. That's a good principle. You put an expectation, you can give a clear job description, but as you see from this, obviously Nehemiah's going around and he's making notes of what is going on and who's doing what. All right? That's the principle of administration. But along with that comes another principle that goes with this. And it's the principle of appreciation. Excuse me, I passed that. Principle of administration. I'm way ahead of myself, aren't I? The principle of appreciation is that You know, you recognize what's been done. One thing we do every year at our church, and it's probably not often enough, but once a year we have what we call our leadership dinner. It's coming up in several weeks down the road. And you should be getting notifications of it. It's probably in your bulletin now that we're having a leadership dinner on such and such date in September. We do it every September, and there'll be probably anywhere from 130 to 140, 50 people there that have areas of ministry. Everybody that's involved in a ministry on any level is supposed to be at that meeting. But one thing we try to do there and try to express there is our appreciation. And that's hard to do when you're that many people, number one, because, man, what our church does and how many people are involved for the size of our church, it's phenomenal. It's exciting to see all these people doing all these different ministries and being involved in ministry. But every one of us, no matter who we are, we need some kind of pat on the back, all right, that you know, that there's this appreciation that's being recognized. You see here what Nehemiah's done. He's listed a whole roll of people, you know. He's giving credit in this chapter where credit is due. It might not make a lot of sense to you, but it does to God. He's the one who led it, you know. It doesn't matter to them, you know, 3,000 years later, 2,000 years later. We're still mispronouncing all their names, but nonetheless, they're here and they're being recognized for what they did. They're being appreciated for what they did. Several things about this principle of appreciation. Obviously, Nehemiah knew their names. Now, that's the mark of somebody who's leading a group to know their names, all right? There's 38 individual names of guys, and he tested about the, and they did a good job. He knows their names. Now, I got in trouble over this one time because a guy came up to me at one of our, I won't say which campus, but he came up to me after the service, and I mentioned him, and I said, "How you doing?" And I named him by first name and shook his hand. He doesn't come real often. He doesn't come real regular. He's not involved in any ministry. But he says, "I bet you don't know my last name." I said, "I bet you're right." And boy, you know, he left the church for about 6 months before he ever came back. But I'm thinking back in my mind, I bet I know the name of every lift leader, first and last name. I bet I know the name of everybody that's in charge of a ministry in this church. I know everybody's first and last name on the stage here that works in this ensemble. I know the first and last name of everybody here who's regularly. Amen? But I may not know your name if you hardly ever hear. You know, if you have to have a search warrant to find you half the time, I probably don't know your name. You know, have to look behind the seats and other seats just to see if you hear. A lot of times, I don't know your name. But I do know who's out there serving the Lord. And I do know which sheep are really functioning in a way that God honoring in their life. And I think it's important to develop, you know, to develop a habit of learning people's name. But even more important, that's learning, hey, to see what they're doing and appreciate what they're doing and appreciate all they're doing for the Lord. Verse 20 has a name in it. Verse 20 talks about, he says, "The next to him was Baruch, the son of Zabbai," catch this, "who zealously repaired another section from the angle to the entrance of the house of Eliashib, the high priest." Kind of circle that word zealously, all right? In fact, that's the only descriptive term in the entire chapter. Other than they said, and they did their work. But when he gets to this guy, he says, "and he zealously did his work." I mean, it's like there's an honorable mention. Everybody else is working, and it's all great what they're doing. But this guy is enthusiastically doing what he's been told to do. I mean, he's obviously worked fast. He works hard. He's committed. He has the right attitude. I mean, he's enthused about what he's doing. Why is he all? I think he probably loves God. He's probably excited. He has a burden and a passion for what's going on. In fact, enthusiasm is a Greek word. At the core of it means, it has to do with entheo, which means in God or God-possessed. And usually when we're really possessed by God and by the Holy Spirit in our life, that's when the greatest enthusiasm shows up. There's another guy I want to give mention to. I think he's a pretty smart guy named Shalom. He's the son of Halohesh. He's the ruler of the half district of Jerusalem. He repaired the next section to him with the help of who? His daughters. It's only mentioned about girls getting out there, but I'm sure everybody's working. You know, and this was a cultural time. Girls didn't do some kind of work. Guys didn't do some kind of work, all right? Women did certain things. Men did certain things. In Hebrew culture, though, beyond any other culture in history, they gave great recognition to women and the great call on women's life and the ministry that women have. So there was, you won't find that in the Quran or some of these other books. But in the Bible, in the Word of God, there's great character. Now, obviously, he's not a chauvinist, is he? And what he says, you know, he's given mention about, you know, here's Shalom, and he's out there with his girls, they're working. They're with their daughters. Now, I'm thinking in the back of my mind when I read that, Shalom's probably got some pretty daughters. And he's a smart guy. I'm going to get out there with the girls, and we're going to start working. I bet we get a lot of young volunteers. Gonna get some help out there. Either way, all right. You know, I bet there's young men on all these sides, those girls helping out with Shalom to do whatever the section of the wall is. But he's giving appreciation and he's giving recognition. And then it says the next section in verse 5 that was repaired by the men of Tekoa. You know, there's those nobles, but Tekoa itself, Tekoa was a hick place. It was a spot in the road. You know, it's not any place to brag about, you know. But they're there and they're doing their part. Except the nobles, you know, the upper crust. Y'all know the upper crust, right? It's a bunch of crumbs held together by their own dough. Think about it, you'll get a minute. He said they would not put their shoulder to do the work under their supervisors. It's interesting to note 3,000 years later, everybody else is honored for what they did. They also remember what they didn't do. It's powerful, isn't it? Honored for what they did? What an epitaph. I mean, when you know, these executives, so to say, were making their own decisions. They wouldn't move brick or mortar, you know. They let all those other people doing it. Think about this. Believers and Christians, 3,000 plus years after that, still know those nobles of Tekoa copped out. Amen. They bailed out. They didn't do it. They blew it. You know? The leadership law is pretty simple, though. The Gord organization recognizes and rewards efforts. You know, as I read this, I was thinking about how Nehemiah sat down and wrote this list of people. I mean, he literally sits down, he starts recording lists. You know, I thought about it, Believer's Fellowship, a list like that. How many people are there? How many people are committed? How many people, you know, are doing the work? How many people have the passion? How many people, you know? How many people have committed themselves to the Lord? A lot of churches, it's really sad. The average church, I think statistics tell us about 20% of the people do 80% of the work. Maybe 10% of the people give 80% of the money. Now, praise the Lord, that isn't true at Believer's Fellowship. I really believe that probably we got about 60% doing 100% of the work, all right? And we probably got about 50, 60% that give 80% of the funds. You know, most of our people understand stewardship and giving and you know, are living their lives by those standards and those principles and realize the importance of that. Same time, they realize the importance of serving the body of Christ. But you know what? Nehemiah didn't throw a fit about these people who didn't do it. He didn't worry about them. I'm just not going to focus on them. You know, wrote it down. This is it. Boom. It's not my duty to be bothered by the facts. As a leader, was he concerned about those people? Yes, he was. As a pastor, am I concerned about that 40, 50% that just aren't going to do anything and not going to be involved and not get in the ministry and not really give? You know, I'm bothered by that. I will speak to them. And it's my responsibility, the Bible says, to encourage them. And if necessary, the Bible says, reprove and rebuke at times. But what we all have to realize, and one thing to me is the greatest motivator, is when a person really understands, now listen carefully, the greatest motivator is a person really understands that one day, you know, God is going to be the one who rewards. God is going to call us in, and the Bible says that we're all going to give an account to the Lord Jesus Christ, according to the scripture. So everyone's going to give an account of himself to the Lord. Now, I don't know about you, but that should put two things. One, either the fear of God in you or great joy. I think the heart desire for most Christians, I want to hear the Lord say, you did good. I don't want to hear the Lord say, why were you such a whiner? I could have done a lot. I gave you those talents. I gave you those gifts. I gave you those abilities. You just blew it. You know, you couldn't cooperate. You couldn't get along. You whined. You griped. You were judgmental. You griped about everybody else in the group. What up with that? You want to be that guy? Ain't no way. Amen. It should maybe scare us if that's been our attitude. But on the other hand, I think there should be a passion. Hey, I want to hear Jesus say, Arms, you've done good. You know, I don't want to say, call the roll. Angel says, okay, next up, Joe Arms. Don't you want to hear, come in the joy of the Lord. You did good. No, you weren't perfect, but your heart was set on it. You kept moving forward. Even in your biggest blow-ups and failures, you kept moving forward. In Luke 16:2, it says that God's going to call us into account for what we did with what we had and what we said with the words that we had. Nehemiah has kind of established this appreciation list. I believe God's got his appreciation list. He's going to express gratitude on that day for those who were committed, for those who sought through the end, those who understood that the ministry of the church and what the validity of the New Testament church was. I really believe that a lot of people don't understand the validity of the New Testament church in church today. I got an article in the email this week about how church members today, you know, even those loyal church members aren't so loyal anymore. That there was a time in America that, you know, if you said you were a faithful Christian, you were in church at least 50 out of 52 Sundays. Sick or vacation link kept you out. Sick or out of town. But every Sunday you were there. But the article is saying that's not so in America today. Even those loyal church members are not there nearly that much. Why? Because we're too busy and we have too many toys and we have too much entertainment and we have too many things that we want to do. We really haven't given consideration. I believe we don't really understand that the church and what the church is and what it's all about. The Bible says Jesus died for the church. Why did he do that? Because it's his bride and he loves the church. I was listening to watching one of these talent shows this last week. I think America Got Talent. Some little girl got up and sang, "This is my church" song. You heard that? Isn't that there in the world? How many of you have heard this song? "Is my church"? Nobody? Quit lying. I don't listen to that kind of music, Pastor. But it's basically a song, and I'm out in the country. I'm out enjoying life. That's my church. That's stupid. I tell you that. That's as stupid as that "Me and Jesus" song got our own thing going. That's stupid too. You know, but that's the idea today. Oh, I'm on the golf course. This is church. I'm worshiping the Lord. You're a liar. You're playing golf. Yeah, I'm going to the lake. I'm going to worship the Lord on the lake today. No, you're not. You know, you're going to fish. Are you going to ski? Are you going to swim? Are you going to play? Let's get real. You know, where's the heart of commitment? Where's the heart of sacrifice today in people's life? Where's that "I've decided to follow Jesus, no turning back. All to Jesus I surrender"? That means my time, my clock, my money, my life. Hey, I really am committed. I'm following Jesus, hell or high water. You know, that's where it gets down to. I'm going to go through the storm, up the mountain, in the valley, no matter where it is, not when it's convenient, when it's inconvenient. I'm going to follow Jesus. That's the heart of the believer. But I don't think we catch that. We don't have that vision anymore. If you really say, "Well, I just don't know if I believe that." If you really believe the Bible's inspired and inerrant and infallible, open the New Testament, start reading. Book of Acts on. Gospel, life of Jesus, glorious. Book of Acts on, the church. In fact, the last days this is referred to is the mystery of the church. This is the church age. This is the church. And what does that mean? That means this is the time right before the coming of Christ. We have this little period of time, how many thousand years, I don't know, but it's here and it's now. And at the end of this, it's going to be recognized with a direct intervention by the rapture of the church. Then the church age is over. The very next event, and we start studying prophecy next month, we're going to see that the very next event in God's prophetic calendar is that rapture of the church. What happens? The church age ends. It's over. And what we did with the church and with Jesus as bride and finding our role and our place in the church, we're going to give an account for that. It's not going to be account, was I a good guy? Not going to be account how much money I made. What I got, to have a boat or not, to have an RV, to have three trucks, three cars, or what I have. How big was my house? That's not what we're going to give an account of. How did we operate within the biblical context of Jesus' body, and it did it matter to us? Was stewardship important? Was service important? Were using our gifts important? Because it is in Scripture. And it puts it this way in 1 Corinthians, always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord. Because you know that your labor is not in vain. Who's he talking to? Well, he's talking to Timothy. No, this is Corinthians. Well, who's Corinthian? It's Corinthians. It's church. It's the whole church in Corinth. It's a letter to the church, applicable to every church. I like the way Anthony Evans, he's one of my favorite preachers in all the world, you know, the urban alternative. Anthony Evans just said, "Hey, if you ain't in a ministry in this church, you ain't a member of this church." That's pretty powerful, isn't it? You don't want to be involved in ministry, don't call yourself a member. Get involved. Find your place. Be a Christian. Be the kind of Christian that God wants you to be. Doesn't mean everybody's a pastor. Doesn't mean everybody has to quit their jobs, work full time. But we're all in ministry. And God calls us to that. Romans 12 says, you know, just as your body, physical body, has many members, these members do not all have the same function. What's that mean? That my hands do hand stuff. And my legs do the leg stuff, all right? My legs, these boots are made for walking, all right? My hands do the hand stuff. My head does head stuff. My torso does torso stuff, all right? My mouth does mouth stuff. Eyes do eye stuff. It's not the responsibility of the hand to see where I'm going. But they all function as one body, it says in Romans 12, chapter 12, verses 4 through 8. They all function. And he goes on to say, so in Christ, we who are many form one body. So here today, we're one. So, but oh no, we're many. No, we're just one. And we all, it says, belong to another. What does that mean? That means that my hand belongs to my foot. And my head belongs to my backside. All right? Amen. My toes, they belong to my fingers. Every part in my body belongs to the other parts of my body. If I hurt one part, bam, I feel it all over. If you suffer in one part, you suffer all over. So he says, what we need to do, he says, we realize that everybody belongs to the other person, so we have different gifts, we use them. We use what God's given. So what's my function? What's my gift? What's my place? What's my part? That's what I want to find out. That's what he's teaching here. Each family did what was expected of it. Each person, where they were at, God used them. In their primary area of service, they went to work at it. They didn't wait for the neighbor to do what they need to be done. And the three kinds of work in Nehemiah, if you break it down. And I'll close with this one. Three kinds of work. One, there was those who did no work, and they're mentioned. I can make a list. There's some folks in our church who just don't do anything for the church. They do no work. They don't invite people. They don't do nothing. They don't use their gifts. It's just, you know. It's like Jesus said, salt without savor. And then we have people who do some work. And they do their work. And they're committed to their work. And they do the work. And then we have some, like Baruch, who, man, they do exceptional work, you know. Here's the thing about it. God notices all three. God saw those who weren't doing anything. God saw those who were doing what they should be doing their share. And he knows those who were going to be beyond the call of duty and doing that enthusiastically. Three kinds. Where do you fall in those three? All right, that's where we have to be honest about. Where's my commitment? Kenneth Strachan, who's a missionary in South America, he made a statement. It was called, by missionary leaders and teachers, it's called the Strachan's Theorem. Here it is. The expansion of any movement is in direct proportion to its success in mobilizing its total membership and continuous propagation of its belief. What does that mean? The expansion of any church will be based proportionally upon how many of us that are part of this church do what God's called us to do in this church, and then the growth will come out of that as we propagate our beliefs to a lost world. You know, anything you say about Believers Fellowship's growth, especially in those first 10 years, because people really got involved. One thing that's contributed to the lack of growth in the last 3 or 4 years has been the lack of involvement. This is what Strachan's theory is, that the more involved you are, then the more healthy it is for the whole body. In other words, the less involved I am in the body, then the more it hurts. And the will of God is for me to be involved. One thing I see about Nehemiah here is that he makes very careful mention of these people, and he cares about them, obviously, and he expresses his compassion, and he expresses his care. One thing about Believers Fellowship, from your pastor, I care. All right? I care about you. All right? And that's not to pat myself on the back. I really do care about you. I pray for you. I trust God for you. I believe God with you. I pray with you. I trust God with you. I don't go home and just write it off and go home and go to bed or watch TV and forget about everything. You're on my heart, you're on my mind, you're on prayers. And it's the same way with many of you. You're the same way. You care. You care about the church. You care about the body. You care about the members. But other of us have gotten to a place perhaps where we become lax and slothful and, you know, just uncommitted. And it gets back to our own personal walk with the Lord many times because we've gotten that way with Jesus in our life. What we have to do is come back to the place to say, Lord, you know, I don't want to be like the nobles of Tekoa, you know. I want to be like what you, this. I mean, there's 38 individuals I stayed here. But they're named individually, but they're all part of one body. You know, I believe that a non-serving Christian is a contradiction in the New Testament. You're just saying that because you're the pastor. Absolutely. My job to say it. But I also believe it's biblical because God says it. There's no lone rangers. We're here together. We're all part of each other. We all have a place. You don't know where it is? Listen, you spend some time with God, he'll show you where it is. I know there's people out here who say, well, Brother Joe, I'd do something if you asked me to do something. Listen, what's God telling you to do? Come tell me. Don't blame it on me because you're not doing something. I'm up here all the time hitting you with a stick.
Get busy. Serve God. Reach the lost world.
Hey, I know this much we can all do. We can all tell somebody about Jesus today. We can all invite somebody to church. We can all quit being stupid on Facebook and use it for the glory of God. Hallelujah. Because I really don't care what you had for lunch. Much as I do love you. Amen. We can make a difference. We are here for such a time as this. The world's messed up. How many would agree? America's messed up. Anybody want to agree with that? Lord knows what we're going to do in election year. I'm praying a lot. But follow world history with me. Every time the globe has been in such chaos and a lack of leadership around the globe, around the world, spiritual leadership, integrity, character, biblical leadership, we're going to chaos, right? And watch what happens. The last time I think I saw a real divine intervention, you know, in America, it was probably back in the 70s when we had the Jesus movement, right? Some of you weren't around for that. Some of you were there but missed it. I almost did. And it was real divine, but the world was nuts. You had the 60s, sex, drugs, and rock and roll, and, free sex, and the whole drug culture was being spewed across the nation. It was, Vietnam, everything. It was just a mess. Everything was a mess. People didn't know right from left, up from down, and God intervened. Just sovereignty. Boom! Millions of people got saved during this little window of 7 or 8 years. Just incredible thing happened. We're at a kind of a time like that right now. Now, we put on our church billboards and bulletins and newsletters. Our heart passion, even in birthing this church, was this. We're here for such a time as this. It's always been when things are the very darkest in culture that the church has shined its brightest. Look at the birth of the church. Rome was leading the world. What a mess. Everything we're seeing today, articulated culturally, is a duplicate of what, just go back and read history, what Rome was. Just a duplicate. No moral standards, no neural fiber whatsoever, no moral backbone, and the church rises. Christianity takes the world. I believe we're in such a time like that. I believe we have an opportunity. I believe if we miss it, we're going to regret it. But I believe the next few years for our church can be phenomenal. We've got to realize we're part of something bigger than ourselves and that we need each other to make it happen. And it will take some commitment. It will take sacrifice. It will mean rolling away from the TV so I can be in a Bible study. It will mean getting out of our bed so I can be in church. It will mean making a commitment to serve people and to care for people. It will mean getting on our electronic devices and saying, well, God's given us this great technological modern age for the glory of the gospel. How can I use it for Jesus? We can do something. We can make a difference. And I believe the stage is set. We should be ready. So let's pray that God would touch our hearts and touch our lives in such a way that we'll set out here like a fire. It'll start with every one of us start praying, God, am I where I'm supposed to be? Am I doing what you called me to do? And if I'm not, I'm ready to get there. Hallelujah. I'm ready to be there. I'm not going to give an invitation this morning, so the band, you can stay right there where you are for a moment, but I am going to ask us all to stand.